All right, so we now have our next panel in which we are going to talk about policy proposals outside the existing legal regime. And we have four presentations and then two discussants. Having seen their abstracts before, let me just tell you they all have, I think, very challenging and stimulating ideas for us. So I'm very excited. So I'll just work down the line and start with Jean Mazo. Please talk to us about ethics rules and campaign contributions.
Okay, I have a little presentation for everybody. It's not fancy because I'm not fancy. Being from Newark and all. So just to start again, this is a problem that I've been thinking about for a long time. I think I have the beginnings of a solution, and I basically need people's help to advance it. This is going to be a shameless plug for the book that all of you want to potentially contribute for with this great co-author of mine, Tim Kuhner. There's Tim, and there's me, and in the middle is my colleague Michael Curtis, with whom I wrote an article. He's a legal historian, and we wrote an article that was published, I don't know, in November or something, called Campaign Finance. What was it called? Campaign Finance and the Ecology of Democratic Speech. And basically, we thought that the problem was like a problem of ecology. In other words, the problem was looking at an ecosystem. An ecosystem has so many fish and so many guppies and so many sharks and so many trees and so forth. And after Citizens United, we used this metaphor of the ecosystem to say that things have changed in our ecosystem. In other words, the power of the wealthy and perhaps corporations has changed. The ecosystem has evolved, and so I always use these slides because it lets me get through 3 minutes with you looking at pictures of fish and me not saying anything of any substance. There's another picture of an ecosystem. So this is how I've begun to think of the problem, but I haven't had the empirics that Sheila has access to in order to say there's more sharks now and fewer guppies, or the sharks are eating the guppies or the fish or whatever and so forth. Again, we are here to talk about the problem of campaign finance, which we talked about, and solutions for how to get around it. I always thought that there were just 9 problems with the system, and they can be shown in one slide. There's the slide, right? There's the problems. And I didn't know of another problem, because Congress used to have in the past the stomach to regulate, and no longer has that stomach. And so the solution that I want to think of, or the solution that I want to propose to you and have you help me think of it, is how we could get solutions which don't involve this problem, that don't have us go through these folks, right? And I think many of us who are lawyers just keep coming back to the court all the time. I was at a Brennan Center event with Rick Hassan, I don't know, in January. Adam was there, some of you were there. And I kept saying, aren't there solutions that don't involve the Supreme Court? And Rick, who's a mensch, kept saying, no, there's just one game in town. It's the court and it's jurisprudence. And I put on my sort of political scientist hat and thought, there's lots of institutions in town. And can't we regulate through another one? Can't we figure out some other way, some other way? And to be honest, it's very, very difficult, because every case we have winds up before these 9 people. Let's say 8 people, one's gone, but there will be 9 again. And even when we think about it, we keep coming back to our jurisprudence, to our Supreme Court jurisprudence. So today, the point of our symposium was to talk about alternative methods of regulating campaign finance, to talk about solutions that don't necessarily involve the court, to talk about solutions either within the jurisprudence where we can move small little things, as people like to tell me when I tell them about kind of our panel, in other words, disclosure or public financing, and then solutions that just, we don't care about the court at all for these solutions to pass. So we've talked about a bunch. I'll put them up there. A better record, or creating a better record. People mentioned that one. More disclosure, better disclosure, different types of disclosure regimes that have always been held up. Vouchers, or democracy dollars, or patriot dollars, as different scholars have called them. All very good solutions that are starting to be used now, as we learned in previous panels, at least on the state or local level. I'm not in favor of democracy dollars. I consider that a kind of New Haven solution, and I always say in writing, it works in New Haven, but it doesn't work in the real world. and then we will hear about an amendment process. But I thought, is there another thing that we can do? Is there any other path that we could have? And I tried to figure one out, and I've tried to think about this, and I haven't done it very well, but you'll help me in a minute. Is there anything else that we can do? Well, here's the problem as I see it. Here's the problem as I see it. In looking for a different path to follow, I began to realize that all of us talk, when we talk about campaign finance, about inputs. We all talk about inputs. We all talk about regulating the amount of contributions or somehow regulating expenditures. And we didn't even compare to other countries, as Keith told us before. In the UK, they do it differently. Expenditures are tightly regulated. Contributions are regulated differently. And we all think about regulating these two things. But this is from some computer slide that I found. We have this input-output system. In other words, the input is what we think about, the contribution or the expenditure. And then there's some process that takes place, right? And then there's some output, and this is what the court has worried about with corruption and the appearance of corruption. There's some output. There's what the legislator does on the back end, right? This is the, you want to call it input-output process. I mean, input, process, output, that's fine. That's fine. If you want to think about it as the quid and the pro and the quo, that's fine. But what I thought about, or the idea that I had, is maybe we could regulate the output. Maybe we don't care about the input. Maybe we care about it to some extent, but maybe if we don't care about the input, what we really want to look at is regulating that output. What we really want to control is what happens at the end with the vote that the that legislator takes. And it turns out, in looking comparatively at parliaments across the world, that outputs can be regulated. That we could prevent a legislator from casting a vote, and even our Supreme Court has upheld this, right? Because the vote isn't his personal vote. It's not his personal First Amendment rights. It's the rights of the people, and parliaments and legislatures and Congress can decide their own internal parliamentary procedures, right? An example is the filibuster, right? But all legislatures, from the New Jersey legislature to the New York legislature, can decide their own procedures. So can't we have just the people in Congress come up with a procedure that will regulate how their colleagues vote, that will regulate the outputs that their colleagues have based on the contributions or expenditures that they receive? That was the idea that I had. Okay? Is it a good idea? I don't know. I need help with it, and I'll show you why in a second. Okay? Now, the first thing is I floated this idea poorly written paper, but it doesn't matter. It was a long time ago and I was young. I floated this idea of using ethics rules, right? Ethics rules have regulated things like gifts and lobbying, and I just don't understand why they can't regulate campaign finance as well. They can, and they do in some states, I think. So we use internal ethics rules. There's some benefits to using these rules. First of all, they're easier to pass. To pass an ethics rule, we just need a majority of these people. That's all we need, right? We just need a majority of these folks. And we don't care about this guy signing anything. And we don't care about what that guy thinks either, right? So there's some benefit. They're easier to pass. We just need a majority of each house to pass these rules, or to pass any rules about procedure that happens in a state house or in each chamber of Congress. The second benefit of these ethics rules is there's no statute there to strike down, right? There's no statute for a court to inherit and strike down, and so there's no judicial review of these ethics rules. The third benefit of ethics rules is that the incumbency rate in this country is very high. I always tell my students that, you know, the president, Obama, was a state senator 4 years before he became president, and they nod their head, and I ask them to name their state senator, and none of them could ever name their state senator. And then I say, do you know why there's a high 90s incumbency rate if you can't even name the person representing you in Raleigh or Trenton or Sacramento or wherever it is? Now, what we see is that the incumbency rate in Congress is always above 90%. I think it's been at 88% in 1994, with the Gingrich Revolution, and then I think it was just below 90% in 2010. And I don't know what the number is. Does anybody know what the incumbency rate was in 2010? I think it fell to 88%. But it's always above 90%, right? And if you think about it, there are only a tenth of the seats in Congress that are changing hands. Out of 435 seats, we have 40 that change hands, potentially. Now, if you're under an ethics investigation, what we have found empirically is that the number of your percentage of winning, the incumbency rate, falls to something like 53 or 54%, right? So being under an ethics investigation makes it much more difficult for you to win office. Now, there are exceptions, right? Charlie Rangel, for example, in Harlem, has been under lots of ethics investigations, and he just keeps on steamrolling through. But he has more and more challengers each time, and it's more and more difficult for him, right? So there are challenges for him in the Democratic primary because people know that these investigations are out there, and it's harder for him. For various reasons, he keeps winning, but, I don't know, 46% of the candidates of incumbents lose. So these are some benefits to using these ethics rules, and we could have ethics rules. Thanks. We could have ethics rules that do various things. For example, we could say it's unethical to receive contributions from people who are not your constituents. It's already illegal to receive contributions from foreigners, but we could just say if you're running for a Congress in Wisconsin, it's unethical to receive contribution from Floridians and so forth. We could use ethics rules in many different ways. Ethics rules, however, only govern contributions. It's much more difficult to link them to expenditures. Not that kind of contribution. See, that was supposed to be a funny slide. All right? Ethics rules only govern contributions, and it's much more difficult to link them to expenditures. And you're supposed to laugh at that slide again. Forget it. This is a serious audience of law professors, I can tell. Okay. And so for expenditures, for this process, the input, process, output, I propose that we use legislative recusal rules. And these rules have again been upheld by the Supreme Court. I think the case is Nevada Ethics Commission versus Carrington, something like that, right? Where the Supreme Court has said that if a legislator violates an ethics rule, that legislature, in this case it was a state legislature, can prevent him from voting, and that is fine. Now, just very few things about this, very quickly. When would recusal happen? Well, it has to happen before the vote takes place. And it's different from judicial recusal, which sometimes takes place after. We can't have a do-over in a vote because democracy would get messed up. So somehow we have to prevent a legislator from voting before a vote on a bill takes place. Who enforces it? And this is a very difficult question. I would propose a creation of something like a recusal committee or a recusal commission. And it has to be independent within Congress that decides when recusal happens. And this is very difficult. What expenditure forces recusal? This is the most difficult part of the problem. We need some kind of standard for when an expenditure happens, if a super PAC spends money, and then what votes a person is recused upon from voting on, the legislature. And I've struggled with this in coming up with these, what I call standards for recusal. I was going to write a paper on this with Dan Takagi at Ohio State, and we've talked about these standards, and to be honest, I need help because I could come up with standards, but they're not very good. Another way I've come up with dealing with this is to do peremptory challenges. So if a PAC spends money on a candidate and he wins in office, when he gets in, the opposing party gets so many peremptory challenges, let's say three, right, and doesn't allow him to vote on certain things. So we think of peremptory challenges as happening in a jury. In other words, without question, you can pull out three jurors. It can't be based on race and so forth, but you can pull out some jurors. Each party has these rights. And this is the method that I would use or propose to use to force, to get super PACs out of the business of running ads for or against candidates, because what we want to do is disaggregate those votes from the interests of that super PAC later and let the other party do that. Okay, final slides are just made for you guys and have no basis. And this is the way to save our Constitution. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Gene. And now Maggie McKinley to talk to us about reforming lobbying. Yay. Welcome, Maggie.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to start by thanking Tim and Gene for taking the risk of inviting a lobbying scholar to a campaign finance conference. And I'd also like to abuse their kindness by spending my entire talk about addressing why the two are completely different. So campaign finance and lobbying are clearly interrelated. Sheila identified this morning that $91 million of contributions in the 2015 cycle came from lobbyists. And she also put up some amazing data on how we spend more on lobbying each year than we do on all of our elections combined. There's no doubt that lobbyists turn to the campaign finance system as a very effective tool within their advocacy toolkit. And Richard Raffault has identified that many of our lobbying laws at the state and federal level have started to identify this distinctive relationship between lobbying and campaign finance, and they've started to regulate specifically the campaign finance efforts of lobbyists as distinguished from other citizens. So surely there's a relationship here between lobbying and campaign finance, but is lobbying the new campaign finance, as Heather Gerken has proposed? In a forthcoming article titled Lobbying and the Petition Clause, I argue that the two are wholly distinct and actually involve completely different constitutional values and questions. My reform proposal that I'll get to today is based on this article, which I'll quickly summarize here. It's going to be available online next month, and I hope that you would read it in depth, but for now I'm going to try and give you 80 pages in just a couple of minutes. So campaign finance is largely focused on elections and electoral speech. That's a majoritarian mechanism, so we have a majority rule in that context. Lobbying addresses direct engagement with government. So from a period predating the founding by hundreds of years up until the 1930s and 1940s, direct engagement with the lawmaking process was actually engaged in through something called the petition process. And that process is distinguished from the current informal lobbying system that we have today. That in that process, citizens would file a formal document with the legislature with a signatory list and a statement of grievance. So it looked a lot like a complaint. The whole process looked a lot more like litigation in a court than our tool of mass politics and informal lobbying. So often those documents, those formal petitions, would include draft statutory language and other forms of argumentation. A lawmaker would take that petition and read it aloud on the floor, which would make it part of the formal record of the legislature, and then they would refer it to either a committee or another branch for consideration and review. That committee or other branch would then file a report back, and then Congress would issue a formal response. That would be a bill, or they would issue a formal declination. Petitions drove the agenda in colonial and state legislatures, and later drove the agenda in Congress, just as lobbying drives the agenda in Congress today. The petition process served actually as a counterpoint to the majoritarian mechanism of the electoral process, and it was designed specifically to provide a platform for individuals and minorities who had particular grievances to be heard during the lawmaking process. So unenfranchised women, African Americans, Native Americans, and the foreign-born used and abused the petition process, and lawmakers provided public, formal, equal, and non-arbitrary process to each. The framing generation then codified these distinct constitutional concerns for this formal process into the petition clause, the clause that many now assume protects our current lobbying system from regulation and reform. So in lobbying in the petition clause, I actually take the heterodox position that the petition clause not only does not protect our current lobbying system, but it actually motivates reform in this area, because our current lobbying system, which is actually constituted through state action, We often think of lobbying through the lens of campaign finance and how do we regulate this private activity, but our lobbying system is actually composed of congressmen and women engaging with the public and affording the public process. That's state action. And currently, they provide state action through informal, non-public, arbitrary, and unequal means. Brent Ferguson identified earlier an amazing political science study that showed that lawmakers are 3 to 4 times more likely to meet with campaign contributors than their own constituents. And that was really just a reiteration of earlier political science studies that confirmed that an hour with a lawmaker would cost about $72,000 in contributions. But there's a very strong correlation between money and procedure and access in a way that we've never found in the political science for money and votes and substantive outcomes. So my reform proposal is grounded on all these earlier arguments about lobbying in the petition clause, and it consists of 3 parts. The first is directed at the Academy, the second at the Congress, and the third at the courts. So, of course, an academic comes in with a proposal for reform that's directed at the Academy, wanting more academics to talk about more things. I will direct this back to a concrete reform proposal, but bear with me for a couple of minutes. So this proposal looks towards reviving the field of legislation. So much of the scholarship within the field of election law and the law of democracy has grown out of the fight for the franchise and out of the optimism that if all of the problems of representation will be solved the moment we put a ballot in the hands of these groups. We're now seeing the limitations of that optimism and also of that framework. Partisanship and redistricting is just one example of how we're having trouble putting new wine in old bottles. But the law of lobbying alone demonstrates that we need to begin a comprehensive discussion specifically on theories of representation. And the traditional site of that discussion, at least in the legal academy, has been the field of legislation. In the mid-1980s, 2 young professors, one from the University of Virginia and another from the University of Minnesota, partnered to bring us the most recent iteration of our field of legislation. Fricke and Eskridge's field of legislation was inspired by the legal process school of thought founded by Hart and Sachs. A portion of their casebook actually reprinted the legal process casebook verbatim, and their work followed on the famed heels of John Hart Ely, also a student of Hart and Sachs, and the publication of Democracy and Distrust just a few years earlier. Legislation as they envisioned it began a discussion within the legal academy of competing theories of representation and examined how the mechanics of legislative procedure and the electoral process affected that representation. So this was a meta-level view of what representation was and how it worked within the lawmaking process. Unlike the law of democracy and election law, which is the lens through which we see a lot of, we look at campaign finance as well as voting and redistricting, those focus on the majoritarian concerns solely in the context of elections. We're not looking at a macro level institutional view. Legislation combined the new legal process view of lawmaking from a process and institutional perspective with the burgeoning study of representation, in particular the representation of minorities. So their scholarship opened the conversation around law and representation, and I believe that we need to revive that conversation generally, but especially as a means to unsettle the discourse around lobbying. So what do I mean by unsettling the discourse around lobbying, and why is this actually important for a concrete proposal in the reform arena? So in 2014, Judge Tatel, writing for the DC Circuit, struck down an Obama administration executive order banning lobbyists from serving on certain advisory commissions. He struck down this ban as an unconstitutional condition on the lobbyist petition clause rights. Judge Tatel's reasoning that lobbying was protected by the petition clause consisted of a single sentence. And I quote, "The government acknowledges," so the government conceded, "as it must, that registered lobbyists are protected by the First Amendment right to petition." In support of this fundamental principle of constitutional law, Judge Tatel provided a single citation to a 1968 DC Circuit opinion. And this two-page opinion wasn't even a petition clause case. Rather, it dealt with whether an advocacy organization could enjoin publication of private of its private papers by a newspaper. This, of course, was such a straightforward application of the First Amendment that the D.C. Circuit held in two pages that the speech clause would prevent such an injunction. The likely reason that Judge Tatel turned to a single lower court opinion is because the Supreme Court has never actually held that lobbying is protected by the petition clause. But here, the government conceded it. Judge Tatel, a liberal lion of the D.C. Circuit, just assumed it. And no one took any offense to that opinion. So our entire corpus of lobbying law and a lot of our scholarship around this issue actually suffers from the same taken-for-granted assumption. I'll go very fast. Congress, the courts, and the academy have all settled into this idea that lobbying is constitutionally protected, and we've failed to look at it critically. French sociologist and anthropologist Pierre Bourdieu refers to this as doxa, or the assumed taken-for-granted assumptions that rest within a society that we need to start to form a critical discourse around in order to actually bring them to light and to understand them. Some of our taken-for-granted assumptions are neutral, so we drive on one side of the road, for instance. Others are less neutral, so the fact that a lower-toned voice sounds more like a leader actually entrenches power with the powerful groups. I begin this process to start to unsettle these discourses within lobbying and the petition clause, but I think that the academy can do more, and I think that legislation can do much, much more. And so we need to start this broader discussion. So turning to the Congress, and specifically, how is it that we can revive the petition process within the Congress? So this would take, as I've described, creating something that looks like a formal court proceeding within an institution that doesn't have the infrastructure now to do that. By statute or ethics rules, we could build out either the clerk's office or the personal offices of each lawmaker with staff attorneys to be able to process in these petitions and then refer them out to committee staff, which will also need to be built out. I think Lee Drutman's work from New America and a lot of the folks with whom he works have done an amazing job of starting a conversation about the lack of funding and infrastructure within Congress and the privatization of much of our lawmaking function into the world of lobbying. So I think we need to bring that back in, and I think the petition process would allow us to do that. We could develop public petitioning dockets, so to make the public to make the process actually completely public, and to establish a website that actually takes the rules of each house as to how to deal with petitioning, and make the and to make those rules accessible to everyone. And then there's also notice and comment process on omnibus bills. Is it okay if I take a little bit longer? Thank you. So this process could also guide Congress in how to build out further areas of government in order to start to deal with petitions. So historically, Congress established the Court of Claims and the Patent and Trade Office in response to petitions, and it could continue to do that in different areas. And then finally, what would this mean for campaign finance? So turning to Jean's example from earlier, this would actually start to have a basis for recusal rules and disambiguating lobbying from the campaign finance system through ethics rules. We can look at how lobbying disrupts the formal process of petitioning and try and find ways to limit that through either by statute or ethics recusal rules or what have you. And there are ways that this can withstand a challenge under the First Amendment, and I'll go into that in questions if anyone has any. Thanks so much.
Thank you very much, Maggie. And now we've got Kent Greenfield to talk to us about corporations and democracy within business.
Thanks, everybody. So I'm here to talk some about the part of the problem that we've been discussing that concerns corporate expenditures and corporate political spending. And here's the solution. The solution is more corporate personhood, not less. So let me explain to you what I mean. So I believe that that the problem of corporate speech and corporate spending is not as bad as we think, but the problem of corporate power is even worse. So let me step through my argument. First of all, I think that corporate political spending is probably less of a problem than we would expect given the rhetoric of this debate. And Sheila knows these data better than I do, but the last time I looked, in terms of the amount of contributions, outside expenditures in the last presidential cycle that came from publicly traded corporations was less than 1%. In fact, we have a dog that didn't bark issue in a way, right? The difference between a Romney administration and an Obama administration, even with regard to the Keystone Pipeline, right, for energy companies, were probably billions of dollars. But we didn't see energy companies spending the expected value of that difference in the election. In fact, the biggest corporate spender in the 2012 cycle was Chevron, which spent $2.5 million. I'm sure they spent more on staples in that period of time than on political spending. And in the meantime, the Adelson spent over 90, the Koch brothers spent over 400. And in terms of theory, that makes some sense. Corporations, because of their legal personality and because of their indefinite life, they have to play both sides of this fence, and they have to take the long view, whereas individuals, human beings, are much more ideologically focused. In fact, I think that corporate speech as a general matter is less problematic in democracy than the rhetoric sets out. In fact, there are a bunch of instances that we've seen over the last few months where corporations have been progressive voices in important debates. The local RFRAs, the Religious Freedom Restoration Act in Arkansas and Illinois and just recently in Georgia have been many of the vocal opponents to those have been corporations. In the Fisher case, the affirmative action case that was argued back in December, the 45 major corporations filed an amicus brief in favor of affirmative action at the Supreme Court. The Anti-LGBT Act recently adopted in North Carolina. Some of the major opponents of that speaking out have been corporations: Google, Facebook, Bank of America, American Airlines. And I think the problem, the constitutional, the doctrinal problem of teasing out corporate speech and even corporate spending because of the corporate status of the speaker are much more difficult than we might think at first glance, in part because corporations are people too, as a matter of law, and their separate corporate personality actually is a valuable thing even under constitutional law. So I think that the difficulty of corporate speech and corporate spending they're not easily accessible by way of constitutional adjustment, or at least not as easily as we might think, separate issue as opposed to the question of spending as a whole. On the other hand, though, the problem of corporate power is even worse than we might think. And this, I go back to Tim's framing remarks this morning, where he was saying that the dominance of wealth in our democracy is the real problem here. And in that respect, corporations and the power of corporations play a really important part. Now that is a product of corporate law, not of campaign finance law. So let me show you an example of what I mean. Now this is a statement in the ALI Principles of Corporate Governance that was adopted a couple of decades ago. And it says that, basically it sets out the purpose of a corporation in the United States. It should be about enhancing corporate profit and shareholder gain. In the United States, shareholder primacy is the norm, is the law. in corporate governance, because of this, has become an alliance between the managerial and financial elite. And this, in a way, is the embodiment of a domination of wealth and institutionalization of it in corporate law. So it strikes me that that this is a major problem, right? When we start talking about campaign finance, it's the major problem of how we get a handle on who makes these decisions. The other thing to say here, right, is that this is not the law in other countries. This need not be the way we govern corporations. It could be that we govern corporations differently. And so here in the United States, because of this shareholder primacy, this in turn creates, and this coalition of power between the managerial and financial elite, meaning between Wall Street on the one hand and management on the other, it creates huge inequalities that get replicated and accelerated in the political sphere. So if you think about the who owns shareholder wealth, it's the very rich. Even with the expansion of pension funds and IRAs, still two-thirds of all stock wealth in the United States belongs to the top, the richest 5% of Americans. So what's the solution to this? I think the solution to the corporate governance problem is an expansion of fiduciary duty to include, to obligate management to take into account the interest of non-shareholder stakeholders. It's changing the structure of corporate governance so that corporate governance is more pluralistic, and to include stakeholder interest. And to include an obligation to consult and govern using stakeholders as one of the consulted and important parties. And moreover, this can happen at the state level because corporate governance law is state law, not federal law in the United States. So why not go this route? Or at least what are some obstacles to going this route? One thing that we've seen since Citizens United, and I think it's interesting, right, is that the rhetoric of shareholder empowerment has been adopted by the left, by the political left. So this statement from the ALI Principles of Corporate Governance, which is embodies the traditionally conservative notion of corporate governance, this is the statement basically I've been spending my career in, as a progressive corporate scholar to fight. Who cites it in Citizens United? Justice Stevens in dissent. This has now become the progressive version and vision of corporate law because we say, oh, they should just be about money. They shouldn't be involved in the public sphere. And in my view, shareholder primacy is not the knight here, it's the dragon to be slain. And ironically, the way to slay this dragon, right, is to make corporations more like people, not less. Here's what I mean. So human beings, right, have a multitude of interests, right? I'm a father and a husband and a scholar and a teacher. We balance those multitudes of interests in each of our lives. Human beings don't act as if making money is the only thing, right? Some of us might know people like that, but they're like the weirdos, right? We have a number of things that we find and we act as if are important, right? The accumulation of wealth and the maximization of wealth is not the paramount good. Human beings, at least most, act with some semblance of conscience. So in my view, the best way to constrain corporations and to ameliorate the problem of wealth domination is to create the structure and the rules so that to mimic these traits of human personhood in the corporate form. It's to make them more like persons. It's to obligate them to make decisions taking into account a multitude of interests. It's to obligate corporations to take into to act as if maximizing money in the short term is not the only thing, to empower them and even to require them to act with something like conscience. Indeed, to make them more like people. And this is another way to say this, is to make them more democratic. So in my view, the cure for the problems that we've been talking about today, about the activities of corporations in democracy, is to put more democracy in corporations. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kent. And now we've got Ron Fine to talk to us about changing the fundamentals of this, amending the Constitution.
Get to the root of it.
Get to the root of it. Thank you, Ron.
Thank you. I have the privilege of presenting on two different panels today, and just to diffuse any allegations of impropriety about that, it was actually Gene and Tim's idea because they said I was trying to squeeze too much of an abstract into just one segment. I'm going to talk right now about a constitutional amendment strategy, and then in the next panel, I'm going to talk about a legislative and litigation strategy. And although I'm talking about these separately, they actually work complementarily. So let me begin for now with a constitutional amendment. So an amendment is a meta-reform in that it's not a specific policy proposal, but rather change to the ground rules that dictate the types of policy proposals. And that may seem rather abstract, but that's actually true of the field of campaign finance as a whole, which is that it's about the rules for making policies that people actually care about. Ultimately, the problem of proper campaign finance regulation is actually a wicked hard problem of policy and politics, but it's only made harder by selective judicial invalidation of available policy tools. And what that means is that while there are many solutions that can be implemented, even under the current legal regime, there are some that can't, and there are some that can't be done in a complete fashion because they're hampered by the unavailability of certain elements of a complete reform package. So for example, voluntary public funding of elections is definitely a reform worth pursuing even under the current legal framework, but it's limited in some ways by the problem of a publicly financed candidate running against a privately financed candidate, either independently wealthy or financed by outside donors, who's not required to participate in the system. That's a problem that goes back to Buckley. It's made worse by Arizona Freedom PAC and Davis and decisions that prevent public financing systems from responding as effectively as they could to this type of problem. I don't mean to say that they don't work at all right now, but far from it. But since Arizona Freedom PAC, we've seen substantial decreases in the number of candidates participating in voluntary state public funding systems in states like Maine and Connecticut. Again, not to say that these systems aren't worth pursuing under the current framework, but that they have limitations that need to be overcome through constitutional change. And the list of policy options that the Supreme Court has removed from the table is long and growing. And for right now, I'm not advocating any particular combination of solutions. The purpose of the amendment is to enable reforms rather than to enact them by de-judicializing the field of campaign finance. And that would give state and local governments, and maybe someday Congress, the breathing room to experiment with different models. And it's important to note that I think we would see at least 50 flowers bloom, and we've got almost 20,000 municipalities in the country. We might see quite a bit of local experimentation. Now, even under the current framework, for example, some states have chosen not to regulate campaign contributions at all. We've got 8 states with no contribution limits, basically. You have other states that are taking full advantage of what they can do right now in terms of contribution limits, but don't have public financing. So you see even right now that some states are not choosing to make use of all of the policy options available to them, and we expect that would continue. We're not naive about assuming that every jurisdiction would look for the maximum possible achievable set of reforms. But there are models that have been tried before that could be revived after constitutional change. For example, rescue funding for public finance systems, and even candidate spending limits. Now, we don't have a great deal of national experience with this, but we do have some, which is the city of Albuquerque, New Mexico, for various reasons, had candidate spending limits in place for years after Buckley. And the reason that it remained in place for years after Buckley was because it worked well, and pretty much everybody was happy with it. And then eventually somebody challenged it, and it was held invalid under Buckley. But we've seen the city of Cincinnati and the state of Vermont have again desired to press with this. And we might even see, after an amendment, entirely new models that have never been tried before, such as mandatory public financing as the only option for participating. So that's why I say this is a meta reform. It enables other reforms. Now, I want to talk now about the amendment movement and how we get there. The amendment movement was launched on the very day of the Citizens United decision. And we recognize that passing a constitutional amendment to overturn not just Citizens United, but all the cases going back to Buckley is hard. But there are two things that are important to understand that are sometimes missing from the discussion. First is that the strategy is bottom up, grassroots, starting in the states, not starting in Congress. So the plan is to achieve resolutions in 38 states where possible through ballot initiative, where that's not available through legislatures, calling upon Congress to pass an amendment and indicating that that state would ratify such an amendment when passed. When 38 states have indicated ratification, that will make the situation in Congress quite different than it is right now. Now, everyone I think here knows that in 2014, this issue did come to a floor vote in the Senate. That was maybe a little ahead of schedule in terms of where we were in the state ratification process. And while it had 55 co-sponsors, it certainly fell short of 67. But it's important to understand in context that when the senators face the prospect of that vote, when their states have already given the equivalent of voter instructions, it'll be a different type of vote. And if you look at the history of other constitutional amendments that have successfully passed, they're riddled with stops and starts. The 19th Amendment, as an example, had a number of failed Senate floor votes before it eventually was passed and then ratified. The second thing to understand about the amendment movement is that outside of the elected official class, it's incredibly popular on a bipartisan basis. And if you look at polls, anywhere you go, on any size jurisdiction, unlike hot button issues right now like abortion or Obamacare or same-sex marriage, Citizens United stands as broadly unpopular as potentially the most despised Supreme Court decision of the modern era. Virtually every poll you look at will show between 70% and 80% of the population in favor of overturning Citizens United and the doctrines that lead to it, with very small differences between Democrats, Republicans, and Independents. And moreover, polls are samples, maybe they're subject to various types of errors. When you actually conduct a vote with a ballot initiative, you get almost everywhere about a 75-25 ratio. It's remarkably uniform, whether you're looking at a city or a state, no matter which state you're looking at. As one example, in Montana in 2012, in the presidential election, Mitt Romney beat Barack Obama 55-42. So it was certainly not a state you would call being in a blue state mood in 2012. But in that exact same election, the exact same electorate passed a ballot resolution calling for a constitutional amendment by a ratio of 75-25. And we see that same ratio everywhere. Furthermore, the amendment movement is an incredibly motivating way to mobilize and energize voters. It gives them an opportunity to participate in the process of remaking constitutional law. And along the way, it's not a bad way of motivating them to work on smaller reforms as well. So I want to talk briefly about the actual text of the amendment. The movement started with a diversified approach to the amendment text. And what I mean by that is that initially the movement started with building support in the grassroots in the states. And there were a number of different bills. And part of the idea was, let's not commit too early to a particular text while we're still building public support. The 2014 Senate floor vote lead to a coalescing around one particular bill, the Democracy for All Amendment, that's lead sponsor Senator Udall in the Senate and Representative Deutsch in the House. And that bill is the one that the major national organizations supporting the amendment, some of whom are in this room, have coalesced around. It contains three provisions. Frankly, some of the language in there is sort of repeating things that other words say there, but it was sort of the type of compromising process designed to get a bill that you have a broad number of people are happy with. And it's obviously not set in stone yet, so by the time the amendment actually passes, and we believe it will, I wouldn't be surprised if the actual final bill that goes through is slightly different than what we're looking at right now. But the core provision basically says to advance democratic self-government and political equality and to protect the integrity of government in the electoral process, Congress and the states may regulate and set reasonable limits on the raising and spending of money by candidates and others to influence elections. There's other clauses in there too. Congress and states can implement by appropriate legislation, and there's also a savings clause as to the press. But that first section is the core provision. I think that there have been a lot of questions about the viability of the amendment movement, given the difficulty of passage. And I think if you step back and take a broad perspective on the amount of effort and time that goes into the constitutional amendment process, there's no doubt that it's a difficult process. It's a long haul, but that's the process that we're engaged in right now. And we find ourselves in a constitutional struggle. And I think that's important to understand, because we didn't start out trying to make it a constitutional struggle. Long before I was involved, campaign finance reform was conceived as a legislative problem that could be addressed by legislatures. And then the Supreme Court essentially started throwing thunderbolts down from Mount Olympus, saying, well, you can't do that, and you can't do that, and you can't do that. You can't have candidate spending limits. You can't have outside spending limits. You can't have aggregate contribution limits. You can't have rescue funding. You can't have contribution limits that we deem too low, and just removing option after option. And so it's become a constitutional struggle, whether we like it or not. And so in order to fully empower the American people to regulate the process of our democratic elections, we need to include constitutional change, from which the amendment is the process that includes the whole of America, not just elites. Thank you.
So we've had four excellent presentations. Thank you all so much for those. And now I'd like to turn to Michael Gilbert and then Stephen Spaulding to provide some sort of commentary on what they've said. Give us 5 minutes of that each, and then we'll do a few questions.
Okay, good. Thanks. I enjoyed all the presentations. I'll follow the same approach as before. I'll offer some comments on each that I hope will be constructive. Starting with Gene, I very much admire your effort, Gene, to look towards other institutions. I think it's true that lawyers and especially law professors tend to obsess over the Supreme Court without realizing there are other players in the universe here. Having said that, I have some questions about whether and to what extent ethics rules would really achieve what you have in mind. So first of all, you gave as an example the possibility that a legislature could impose upon itself a rule saying that it's unethical to accept contributions from people who are outside of the district. Well, I don't understand how that is going to apply, or something like that's going to apply, to challengers, because they're not bound by the ethics rules. So they could accept these while the incumbents cannot, and of course as soon as the incumbents realize that, they're not going to sign on to the ethics rule. The other thing I would mention is I think what you have in mind for recusal is once you've received a big contribution, now you should be recused from voting on a bill that impacts the interests of the contributor. Okay, well, just reverse the order of operation. Instead of the money first and the vote second, cast the vote first and deliver the money second. Now it's going to be harder to force recusal. The last thing I'll mention is maybe I'm cynical. Legislators are clever and they can bargain. Okay, so if the contributor gives money to A and now A has to recuse, A knocks on legislator's B door and says, hey, vote for that contributor's interest. And the next time a contributor gives you money, gives B money, and B has to recuse, we'll pay you back. It just seems to me that there will be a lot of loopholes. But I like the idea of looking past the court to achieve it. It's just the details are hard. Okay, so turning to Maggie's paper, I really look forward to reading the full version of the paper when it comes out next month. Just a couple of comments. The first one is, to the extent you want to use this historical petition process, which I don't know anything about and I'm really fascinated to learn about, to the extent you want to use this historical practice either to give legal or policy weight to reinvigorating this practice going forward, it's going to be really important, I think, to show that the historical practice really worked in such an excellent way as you described it. So you didn't go into details, and you have them, and I obviously don't, but you described the historical process as being fair, unbiased, open, and so forth and so on. Again, maybe I'm too cynical, but it's hard for me to believe that a country that long held slaves and discriminated on the basis of race, sex, religion, and everything else you could think of had this magical process by which anyone could come in and members of Congress would listen to them and take them seriously. Maybe it exists. I would love to see that it does. But it seems to me that establishing that is an important piece of the argument. The other thing I wanted to ask about is, even if you establish the process that you have in mind, how do you make the legislators listen? And how do you make them actually respond to the people who show up and go through this process? If we still have the raising and spending of money operating in the background, and a legislator has someone appear before them as part of this process, that legislator might be thinking the whole time, are you going to give me money? Because that's really what I need. And if the answer is no, you can keep talking and I'm not going to listen. I just wonder how you make it bite. You can get people in the room maybe, but how do you get people to listen and actually respond to it? Maybe there's a way, I don't know. So just briefly on Kent's paper or presentation, a quick comment on the dog that didn't bark. The argument here is that many people predicted corporations would spend a lot of money on elections after Citizens United made it possible, and in fact, the spending doesn't appear as bad as many people predicted anyway. That's true. On the other hand, Citizens United did more than empower corporations to spend money. It empowered them to threaten to spend money. So if you're trying to buy a vote or some other political favor, there's at least two ways to do it. You actually spend the money to buy it, or hey, even better yet, just threaten to spend the money against them unless they deliver it. Now you get what you want and it doesn't cost you anything. So it's possible that a system of campaign finance disclosure reveals quite little corporate spending on politics, and yet everybody's bought and paid for in the background by these threats, and we can't observe that. It's a big empirical limitation here. With respect to your, that's kind of an aside though, with respect to your main thrust to make corporations more representative, I know you've done a lot of thinking about this. I've done very little thinking about this. I'm just gonna say one little piece relevant to the campaign finance stuff. I understand the idea that, well, first of all, I think for small corporations, for nonprofits, I'm not sure how representative you can make them if it's a plumbing company, say. Big ones, I understand, but a little one, I don't know. On the other hand, maybe they don't spend that much money in politics, so we're not worried about them. With respect to larger corporations, making them more democratic, I can see how that could reduce corporations' role in politics. So suppose you have, just to make it easy, you have management and labor in the corporation, and the company would otherwise spend money on some pro-management policies, but because they're not democratic, they don't do that. Okay, that works. But imagine another scenario where it's management and labor, and what both of them are interested in are more sugar subsidies or something like this. Well, now their interests are aligned, and the corporation will spend money to get that. So to kind of put a fine point on it, I think for your process to work, the stakeholders that you draw in must have competing interests. And sometimes they will, but sometimes their interests will be perfectly aligned, and when that happens, I'm not sure you reduce the threat. And then finally, on Ron's presentation, I love the idea of a constitutional amendment. It seems to me, I've seen these polls too, it seems to me that the likelihood of something like this passing is greater than the likelihood of the many other, in some cases, crackpot amendments that have been proposed. And I love that you gave us the language, because I wasn't familiar with it. You said, let's dejudicialize the process, and the first thing I thought of is, well, somebody's got to interpret whatever the language of this new amendment is, but it seems to me you gave pretty convincing language. The only thing I'd say there, and you all are the experts, not me, but with respect to the advocacy piece and trying to sell it, you know, you have to get actual state legislators to approve this thing. It seems to me it's in their interest to pass this. They don't want to spend all their time raising money and having to, you know, lick people's boots to collect what they need. And it seems to me that there ought to be a lot of corporate sponsors behind this too, because they don't want to get calls asking for money. So I, you know, I think there's hope. I wish you luck.
Right, thanks for everybody's presentations. Professor Mazo, I am an optimist, but I am struggling with the process, in the ethics process in both the House and the Senate that we watchdog and observe all the time. But also there was one, I think, hurdle that wasn't discussed, which is it would actually, I think, take a supermajority in the United States Senate to pass this rule for a few reasons. One of which is, of course, the rise of the 60-vote Senate, where literally every motion needs either unanimous consent or 60 votes to move forward on a vote on an underlying bill. But Rule 5 and Rule 22 of the Rules of the Senate say that the Rules of the Senate apply from Congress to Congress, and Rule 22 says it actually takes a two-thirds vote to invoke cloture on a motion to amend the rules. So to pass a new ethics rule or a new gift rule in the United States Senate, you'd actually need to get 67 votes, assuming all those are present and voting. Now, you can question the constitutionality of that kind of entrenchment, and many scholars, there's a rich body of scholarship about the constitutionality, not only of the 60-vote rule, but of Rule 5 in combination with Rule 2, which, again, these rules were put in place in 1917 and rarely have been amended. The nuclear option in 2013 to set the threshold for cloture to 51 is just a precedent. The text of the rules still say it takes 60 votes or 3/5 of the Senate to invoke cloture. So I think there's a challenge in terms of passing an ethics rule in the United States Senate that's going to require more than a majority. Then, in terms of insulating ethics rules from judicial review, I think there is another line of Supreme Court cases that we brought up in some litigation when we were litigating actually the constitutionality of Rule 22 and Rule 5, which says that Article 1, Section 5 is not an unlimited power, and that while the House and Senate have the right to adopt their own internal rules and proceedings, those rules and proceedings cannot conflict with other constitutional constraints. The Bailyn case and the Smith case took it one step further and said when the rules of the House and Senate affect individuals outside of the chamber, the question is necessarily a judicial one. It was a unanimous Brandeis opinion that looked at the scope of the Senate and House's rulemaking authority. So I'm not yet convinced that it insulates the rules from judicial review. Then I think you may have the same problem that you have with the FEC concerning enforcement. The ethics enforcement process is a black box. It is behind closed doors, and it raises reasonable suspicions that the judge and jury are only, you know, that they're acting in their interests are not necessarily to uphold the ethics rules, but you have a situation of foxes guarding the hen house. In the House, we actually had to set up we didn't actually set it up, but we advocated for the Office of Congressional Ethics, which is now an independent watchdog of the actual ethics process, to provide some more transparency to the process. It operates sort of like a grand jury. It's made up of former members of Congress and others that issue public reports of their investigations before referring them to the Ethics Committee. So those are just some of the challenges that I think come up in using the ethics process to otherwise pass rules governing contributions and expenditures. Full disclosure, I'm a registered lobbyist, so Professor McKinley, I'm looking forward to reading your full paper too. But just, you know, every day, just this week, particularly in the House, the people that I interact with every day are usually 23 to 24, maybe 25-year-old, fresh out of college, young people. Particularly after Speaker Gingrich slashed the budgets in the House and Senate, it's really outsourced a lot of this legislative work, as you discussed, to professional lobbyists. Lee Drutman and Christine Mahoney just issued a terrific paper just this week that puts forward some interesting ideas that I think you touched on, where you could go up on congress.gov and registered lobbyists at this point, their proposals that registered lobbyists could post their position papers for the public to see, and then people could go on and comment, sort of like a rulemaking proceeding. But you know, one figure that they bring up is that there are $2.6 billion in annual corporate lobbying expenditures last year, which is more than the $2 billion combined budget of the House and Senate. So again, I do think this is a matter of increasing resources. Another full disclosure, Professor Greenfield was my corporations professor at Boston College, so I've spent quite a bit of time thinking about democratizing the corporation. And you know, I would just flag one piece of legislation that's pending in the Senate. It's actually sponsored by Senator Menendez, which doesn't extend the reach toward all non-shareholder stakeholders, but would require shareholders to vote on an annual corporate political expenditure budget. So it would, I think it might be, I'd be interested in your comments, but it might be one step towards democratizing political spending. And again, I would urge folks to think about not just federal spending. Oftentimes we're talking about how much corporations are spending at the federal level, but we know at the state judicial races, and at the state and local level, at the city council level, that corporate money often actually does come with more of a bite. And we've seen that play out in Wisconsin. Wisconsin Club for Growth spent a lot of money on Wisconsin Supreme Court justices who were then ruling on the governor's political campaign. That's a case study, I think, in what corporate money can do at the local level in a way that is fundamentally anti-democratic. And then just to talk a bit about Ron's presentation, you know, in addition to the merits of a constitutional amendment, you know, we've seen with our members, it has brought people into the process to think about not only a constitutional amendment, but other reforms like small donor public financing, like disclosure legislation. And also, I do think it sets the stage for a new jurisprudence. When this hearing took place in the 113th Congress, the Judiciary Committee held multiple hearings about the Democracy for All Amendment. It was packed. Many of those same staffers and senators are now meeting over the next month with Judge Garland behind closed doors. And we know that, for example, Senator Gillibrand already tweeted out that she discussed campaign finance with Judge Garland. So it has set the stage for introducing the ideas, the merits of the amendment into the ether and into the bloodstream, and I think will pave the way towards a new jurisprudence, even if it is not enacted as the 28th Amendment.
Great. Thank you for the presentation. And we have a few minutes to take a couple questions, if there are some. Start back here. Go ahead, Ann. Sorry.
So this is Professor Greenfield. So I take your point about the elevation of shareholders, but why is it not consistent to say, yes, we should be democratizing our corporations, but nonetheless, for-profit corporations are essentially economic entities, and so really have no legitimate role to play in our political discourse. So regardless, yes, we should be democratizing them for their own, you know, because we want things to be more fair in the economy, but when it comes to our politics, we as citizens and humans are the ones who are properly engaged in the political discourse, the political process. A for-profit making entity is supposed to exist at our pleasure, essentially, right? And so why can't we just do both?
Yeah, so Adam and I, you and I have talked about this in the past, and I think this is a tough, I think the doctrine here is hard to sort of figure out exactly where the line should be. I'm confident that for-profit corporations should get some speech rights, and I'm confident to say that they should not get all the speech rights that human beings get. Now, where that line is drawn is a difficult question. But for, you know, the New York Times is a for-profit corporation, and it deserves free speech rights.
Not necessarily qua corporation, it's a media entity. It has rights that are not dependent on its corporate status, right?
Of course, but I take the point, I take the argument of those who want to take away speech rights from corporations that the corporate entity status removes those rights from that corporation, right? It's not that corporations automatically get rights that an association of individuals wouldn't otherwise have. I think the hard question is there are some times when the speech rights of corporations are do distort the marketplace of ideas, and that's because I think Buckley was wrongly decided in that respect. But I think it's wrongly decided whether the person who's distorting the marketplace of ideas is an individual and spending a gazillion dollars, or a corporation spending a gazillion dollars. So that's the nut that's tough to crack. In terms of theory, though, it turns on your theory of the First Amendment. If it's a marketplace of ideas, then the speaker who the speaker is doesn't affect the analysis much. If it's a Michael John theory of public discourse. Again, the nature of the speaker doesn't necessarily disempower a corporate speaker from entering into that debate. Although I think there's a better argument that it provides an interesting analytical cap, right, if you were talking about a town meeting analogy. And I think the autonomy reason, I think there are more arguments in favor of limiting corporate speech as because they're not persons, but listeners still deserve to hear the speech of corporations. If you think about the video game case from a few years ago from California, where California put caps on the kind of violence that kids could use, and that's a corporate speech case. I mean, and if you believe that it is the right of people to buy video games that are uber violent, the corporate status of the seller doesn't really play into the analysis.
Richard.
Oh, great. Gene, I want to applaud this effort to try and reframe this in ethics, but I do agree with one of Michael's comments that this is going to be harder as well as Stephen's point. So first on Michael's point, which is obviously right, the person doesn't regulate outsiders, which means not just the challengers, but super PACs and C4s and any other campaign participant. You can't apply ethics constraints to all the people we're worried about, the earlier panels today about dark money and other groups. Second, I'm not 100% sure that these things are immune from judicial review. Maybe the congressional ones are under Article 1, but if we're talking about the 50 states and all the cities, the Nevada Commission on Ethics case didn't immunize it from judicial review. They just said there wasn't a violation in that case. There wasn't a First Amendment violation because of the intimate connection between the member of the local zoning board and the interest and the rezoning that was in front of the board. It wasn't a campaign finance case. It was more about friendship and other kinds of personal ties. So it wasn't that it was not reviewable, it's just that it wasn't a violation. I mean, a court that decides Arizona Free Enterprise that says that there's a chilling effect on somebody's speech because somebody else gets some assistance might very well conclude that there's a chilling effect on contributions because the recipient of the contributor is being penalized and thereby discouraged from taking it. So I'm not 100% sure this, and then the solution to finding, of course, that Stephen's point about the actual operation of the two, if you watch ethics in action within legislatures, the most famous episode, I think, in the modern Congress of enforcing ethics, well, I guess I'm not thinking about Rangel, thinking about Senator Cranston, which was a campaign finance case of sorts, when he and the Keating Five were accused of using the fact they were receiving certain contributions from the Lincoln Savings and Loan and from Mr. Keating to try and influence legislative administrative action. They were tied up in knots for years before ultimately concluding with a resolution of censure on one member and sort of backing off on, and that's something a little bit weaker on somebody else. And that was sort of controversial because as they themselves recognized, it was actually very hard to figure out when did constituent service go too far. So I think, and then the one I know better is New York State system, where the state has changed its ethics system three times, and still the outside ethics agency has no real power over the legislature itself. Things get sent to the legislature, and nothing happens. You know, the other ethics agency that I nicely got one I sit on actually does sanction legislators, but we're not inside the legislature. We actually sit outside the legislature, but have jurisdiction over the legislature. So we just hit the Speaker of the New York City Council with a rather large fine, but we're not their creature. Whereas I think most, Congress regulating itself is going to be very hard to do. One last point on the corporation. This is not, I basically agree that Citizens United has been overblown in terms of its effect, but it is worth pointing out what is not really a Citizens United problem, really a First National Bank of Boston versus Bilotti problem. Corporations are huge participants in ballot proposition elections. I agree that they scarcely participate in candidate elections because they don't want to get on the wrong side of the winner, and because it's more efficient to lobby for your specific tax break, your specific regulatory change, rather than actually affect who wins, influence the winner. But they're very big participants in ballot proposition, which again precedes Citizens. It doesn't really disagree with your point, but it's worth noting their role.
Yeah.
And then one last thing about corporations is, I agree, it's the business corporation we shouldn't focus on. I think the corporate form is a problem because it's so easy to create them. And that's why I think, to me, the real problem with corporations is not that they're big money, because many of them are not, and they're certainly not necessarily wealthier than the people behind them. I mean, that's between Bill Gates and Microsoft, I don't care. But it's so easy to generate lots of corporations that if we actually try to enforce disclosure rules or someday maybe spending limits, generating more Americans for prosperity, Americans for good government, Americans for anything else, is a way of getting around them, just as we discovered in New York City and New York. You know, real estate interest is one real estate interest that had 25 LLCs. And they were all the same address, but they were all separately created. And I think that, to me, is the corporate problem, if there is a distinct problem. I come to agree with you that corporations aren't the real problem, but it's the ability to proliferate shells that I think is the actual problem.
Want to reply to that? Either quick replies or?
Go first.
Oh, please.
Just very quickly, thanks both Stephen and Richard for pointing out issues. I mean, in my mind, I was trying to float the ethics rules as a way of regulating contributions and the recusal rules separately as a way of regulating expenditures. And I do see the problems that you pose, and there's, as I said, to me it's early work that I'm still working my way through. But it seems that there isn't a problem with forcing a legislator to recuse. And so the question with independent expenditures is a really difficult one. In other words, Mr. Oil spends, you know, big oil spends money, and then legislator, runs ads for legislator, you know, X from Alaska, and then we just say, you know, legislator X in Alaska can't vote on oil interests. That one's really easy, right? But the really hard one is really wealthy person with lots of financial interests or lots of different interests. Spends money on ads to get legislator A elected, and then what is it that we're now allowing this person to vote on? Because there's lots of little interests, and what's the standard that we use? And this is something that I've struggled with and not come up. And actually, Dan Takagi and I have had many phone conversations about this, and it's just, you know, he has a scrutiny thing that he comes up with, but my kind of solution is if you spend. Once this legislator, once this candidate gets in, the opposing party can just have three peremptory strikes, or five or ten, or whatever it is, and say, there's 10 votes that we can take away from him, and one can be on whatever interests we think that wealthy person has. And that kind of system, I mean, we have this kind of private ordering literature, this kind of super PAC insurance, and, you know, and contracting around Citizens United. The problem with that is that there's a collective action problem in entering into those things. In other words, we had a contract to get around independent expenditures, but when Scott Brown ran the next time in New Hampshire, he wasn't going to enter into another contract like that because it wasn't good for him, right? So you have to have some kind of parliamentary procedure that threatens the spending in some way. And that's what I was trying to get at, and I see the problems that you have. I've done this presentation before, and the real problem, and it's the one that Mike posed, is it doesn't affect challengers, right? And it doesn't affect challengers. It only affects them once they become an incumbent again. I don't really know how to get around that one. And this is why I've tried to have these kind of peremptory things where, since we have this two-party bellwether system, where if spending happens, the opposing party just gets to take votes away from you, and you might not want to spend. Again, the mechanics are difficult, and this is, and I'm trying to, you know, get from here to there. But you might not want to spend on somebody who then you later know can't actually vote for your interests. If we could disaggregate that somehow, the spending from their ability to vote, if we had a mechanism that could do that perfectly, and in theory we have it, just in practice it's very difficult to implement. I'll just stop there.
So 60 seconds. First of all, I want to say how proud I am of the fact that Stephen is a student, was a student of mine.
Thank you.
This is the kind of thing that makes professors like beam, right? Like that I appreciate the work that you do. In terms of the shareholder, disclosure stuff, it's part of my answer is the point that I made with Kate earlier, which is that disclosure only matters if you can do something with it, and shareholders, you know, always vote with management, right? And it's, in some ways, it's the problem that Michael had too. Is like they will, and then they will absolutely vote with management when it's in their, when management and shareholder interests align, which is all the time. So, and it actually it goes to your point too. Is that, and if shareholders get a chance to vote, all you do is create 100% owned, wholly owned subsidiary, and then then have the voting done with the subsidiary, because who's the shareholder of the subsidiary? The parent corporation. Who votes those votes? The directors. So you can totally disable Now, that is also replicated if you have a stakeholder board, but it's less, you're going to be less able to create the subsidiary with a stakeholder board if the purpose is to disempower the people who are on the board.
All right, and with that, I will say thank you to our panelists, and we'll take a brief break.